Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our mains answer writing series, in which what we do, we daily give you a question of which you have to write the answer. So friends, students were demanding that please also upload the model answer of the question that you, that is provided by us. So depending focusing upon that demand, considering that demand, what we have decided that we will discuss daily one model question, model answer with you. So let's discuss what is the answer, what is the question of today and its answer. So the question is, HTBT cotton was recently seen in news. What is it? What are its advantages? Discuss the crop in the broader perspective of issues associated in general with the GM crops. So the word limit is 250 and the maximum marks are 15. So here you have to discuss about the HTBT cotton, and you have to discuss the issues associated with GM crops in broader perspective. So before starting, let me tell you friends that this is not a model answer. You can take it only as a reference source, because friends, we don't call our answers as model answer, because no answer can be model answer. Each answer has its positives and negatives. So had that been the case, that is the case of the model answer, the UPSC toppers would have scored 100% marks. But the marks of UPSC toppers range between 50 to 55%. So for that purpose we don't call any answer model answer. We just use this terminology because students use this name for the answers. We call it just reference source. So you can see in the heading also we call it reference sources, and special note is given by us here that this is not a model answer, take it only as a reference source. So let's start discussion, let's discuss the answer. So friends, why it was in news? Because in Hisar there were some farmers who defied the government ban, and this planted HTBT cotton in Hisar district. So but then government decided to proceed with actions, and then proper action was taken. So what is HTBT? We must understand this before answering this question. So HTBT basically stands for herbicide tolerant BT cotton, and it is genetically modified crop. But friends, it is not approved as yet in so it can't be planted in India. So technically what is herbicide tolerant? So before herbicide tolerant, we must understand what is herbicide. So herbicide is like a poison which is used to destroy unwanted vegetation. So you might see in the agricultural fields there are many types of herbs that grow, and they are mostly called weeds because they are not valuable for the crop that is grown on the field, because they compete with the resources with the crop which is planted which is sown in the field. So herbicide, basically for this purpose herbicide is sprayed. So herbicide is like a poison which prevents the growth of such kinds of weeds. But the problem with herbicide is that when it is sprayed, when the spray of herbicide is made, it also affects the crop crop production, because the crop production also gets reduced. So due to this, the yields of the farmers decrease, and hence it has direct bearing on the income of the farmers. But what this herbicide tolerant BT cotton does, it basically makes the cotton, that is cotton seeds that are sown, resistant to the herbicides that are being sprayed for the purpose of eliminating weeds. So when the herbicides are sprayed, then this problem of decrease in the yield of cotton crop is reduced, because the crop doesn't get affected by this herbicide. So that is basically the unique quality of HTBT cotton. So because introduction of HTBT cotton, with its introduction there won't be any impact of herbicide on the cotton crop, while the unwanted vegetation will be destroyed. So what are the advantages? So simple is the thing that obviously if a herbicide is affecting the crop, and when we spray it on HTBT cotton and it is tolerant, it shows resistance to this herbicide, then obviously the yield of the farmers will increase, and obviously they will harvest better yield, and they will their income will directly increase. So it will also reduce the cost of the labor. So one point here must be noted, that that it is said that of sowing the cotton, 40% of the cost is there to remove the weeds that grow in the field. So by spraying herbicide, the growth of such weeds can be controlled, and thus the cost of labor can be saved, but now the farmers use labor instead of herbicide, because basically this spray of herbicide reduces the the output of the crop as well, cotton crop as well. So that's why less chemical is used. So in case of if there is HTBT cotton, then obviously it will be tolerant and it will increase yield, and also it will increase income. So it will also reduce cost of we can say sowing the crop. So now, what are the advantages of GM crops in general? Because the question was to discuss about the GM crops in broader perspective. So what are the advantages? So first is food security. So this point is being touted by those who support GM crops. They say that it increases food security, because obviously yield increases, and when the yield increases, then obviously the production will increase, and this will ensure food security. So also due to increasing urbanization, there is lesser and lesser area available for the cultivation. Population is increasing, demand is increasing, urbanization is happening, and agricultural fields are put to different land use. So for that purpose, GM crops, what they will do, the productivity will rise in the lesser amount of land. So that will ensure food security. Other thing is that it improves the stress tolerance. So for example, as I've given the example of cotton, so when it is tolerant to herbicide, then obviously its production will increase, and it can tolerate the stress that will be there by the spraying of the herbicide. And then also these GM crops can be engineered to be tolerant to drought conditions, or for example low temperature conditions, or you can say salty conditions. So this helps in kind of expanding the food crops in the regions where they are not sown. For example, if in Rajasthan rice is, for example, not grown, because rice needs a lot of water for its cultivation, but water is not there in Rajasthan. So but by genetically for modifying, the seeds of the rice can be made drought resistant, and they can be planted in Rajasthan as well. So this is just an example. So it can extend the range and open up new areas for food production, and also it ensures faster growth, because it reduces that cycle, that is sowing cycle and harvesting season. So it reduces that, and for example, if a particular place has short season of growing and then harvesting, so that will be reduced. For example, in North India, there is lot of problem of stubble burning. So why it is done? Because it is done after the kharif crop is kind of harvested, and when the rabi crop has to be planted. So in between, the time is less, and the stubble has to be removed. So simply farmers, what they do, they burn the stubble there, and this causes a lot of air pollution relating to particulate matter 2.5 and other harmful gases as well, and this causes a very high level of pollution in New Delhi. So this can be reduced. Say for example, if the growing season is shortened, and these GM crops grow faster, then obviously there will be enough gestation period available between the harvesting of the kharif crop and the sowing of the rabi crop, that stubble can be effectively managed without it being burned. So this will ensure faster growth, and also it will ensure that for example, if in a particular area there is only one sowing season, so it will in case of GM, if the GM crops are introduced, the growing the time period required for each harvest can be reduced, and can in places where there is only one harvest, it can promote two harvests. So then there is also a point that is more nutritious crops. So the crops can be particularly engineered, seeds can be particularly engineered to produce a particular vitamin or micronutrient in a large protein or carbohydrate in a large quantity. So that can help in reducing this malnutrition problem that is there. So this production of food designed specifically for a healthy diet for all consumers. And then is resistance to herbicides, as I have told you. So in case of cotton, you can take that example. So next is economic benefit. So what is the economic benefit? First of all, the cost of input is reduced because labor is not required to remove the weed. And then there is also, it is said that when the production yield increases, then obviously the income will also increase for farmers. And then also it is said that GM in GM crops, we can extend the shelf life of a particular food crop. So this will ensure that the food crop can be stored, can be transported and can be stored for longer distances. So this will ensure that economic benefits will be there. So export benefit can be enjoyed by farmers who sow crops that that have lesser shelf life. So this will ensure that economic benefits can be enjoyed. And then is case study of BT brinjal. So in case of BT brinjal, genetic engineering appraisal committee approved it in 2009, but under the pressure of activists, the government disallowed its planting, that is of BT brinjal. But the Bangladesh, using this report, that is of genetic engineering appraisal committee report, it went ahead. So today about 17% of the country's brinjal farmers grow BT brinjal in Bangladesh. So it has reduced the pesticide costs of the farmers by 61%. So obviously lesser amount of pesticide is required, and Bangladesh BT brinjal farmers' net returns per hectare are 6 times his non-BT counterpart per year. So then there is also environmental benefit. So what is the environmental benefit? In 2017, 189.8 million hectares of biotech crops were planted in 24 countries. So what does it mean? So how it can ensure environmental benefit? The environmental benefit can be ensured by saving the land that is used for cropping the plants. So the simple point is, in 2017, 189.8 million hectares of biotech crops were planted in 24 countries. So the yield that was achieved the same yield level, more than 300 million acres of conventional crops would have been needed. So obviously, when that much amount of land was required for increasing same yield standards, then obviously the same land that could be used for different purposes. For example, the plants can be planted there. So obviously land use change will ensure that emissions are reduced. And also, according to UK consultancy firm, that is PG Economics, so first 20 years of biotech crops have seen a reduction of pesticide spraying by 671.2 million kg. So it is said that with the genetically modified crops, the pesticides and the chemicals that will be required to prevent and increase the yield, they will be less, and obviously that will help in preventing the cost of the farmers, as well as it will ensure that chemicals doesn't enter this food chain, according to this UK consultancy firm, the environmental footprint associated with the pesticides that have been not used is basically 18.4%. 18.4%, which has been reduced. So the figures of 2016 also show some similar results. So basically the point is that land that is used for cultivating crops that can be used for different purposes for different land use, and then it will also prevent the use of chemicals, for example pesticides and fertilizers. So now what are the concerns, challenges associated with GM crops? So the first thing is human health risks. So there is potential impact on human health, including allergens and transfers of antibiotic resistance markers. So what does it mean? So those who are against the GM crops, they say that if we are introducing a particular gene into a crop, and then it is if in case it is tolerant to a particular pesticide, then it can also lead to antibiotic resistance in human beings, or it may include introduction of allergens in that crop, which could then impact human health, because ultimately that if that toxin that will be produced in the crop, that might also affect the health of the person who will eat that crop. So the impact of GM crop poses risk to human life as health, as the resistance to antibiotics can turn medicines ineffective and may result in the formation of new toxins and allergens. So also toxins produced by GM crops, they may not only affect the target organisms, but they may affect only also non-target organisms, and also they pose the danger of allergens and unintentionally introduced that antibiotic resistance. So antibiotic resistance is also a major concern in today's health scenario. So then there is biosafety concerns. So it is said that say for example, as I have told you, that herbicide tolerant BT cotton, in that case when it is tolerant to pesticide, then obviously it releases a toxin that prevents the effect of pesticides on it. So that toxin can also target those that are not the intended targets of this crop. So this can reduce species diversity. So insect resistance plants might harm insects that are not their intended target. So also cross pollination, it is said that cross pollination in GM crops, it paves the way for herbicide resistant super weeds. So it results in the formation of super weeds that can further threaten the sustenance of other crops and pests because of its uncontrolled growth. And also it allows the transfer of genes from one crop to another, creating super weeds which will be immune to common control methods. And also more potent viral viruses can be generated. Say for example, if viral genes are inserted in a particular crop for the purpose that they release toxin, and these viral genes after interaction with other viral pathogens, obviously in biodiversity everything is linked. So these viral genes, when they will interact with other viral pathogens, they may get transferred into them, and which can lead to new and more virulent virus strains. And what are the implications for farmers and consumers? So it is said that GM crops will reduce input cost, but critics say that the seeds that will be provided to the farmers, those seeds will be patented by the companies who will be doing the research in genetic modification of such seeds. So obviously when the companies will get the patent of the seeds, and when the one country get patent, then it can obviously charge huge amounts to the farmers for giving that GM crop. So obviously farmers will have no choice but to shift to these GM crops, because the weeds that are not surviving in particular field, they will obviously the weed will shift to the other farm as well, other field as well. So in that case, that farmer will also be forced to adopt these GM crops without his will, and then this can in fact lead to a dangerous degree of control over the food supply. So it is said that domination will be there in world food production by a few companies. And also National Institute of Agricultural Economics and Policy Research anticipation that BT Brinjal's high yield and increased shelf life will benefit consumers and farmers owing to cut in retail price of brinjals ignores the scenario that companies might charge premium prices for BT Brinjal seeds, in which case farmers may not benefit at all. And then economic concerns are also there, as I have told you already, that the introduction of GM crops is not that easy. There must be approval, and then there must be proper trials. So it is a lengthy and costly process, and it is not necessary that the yields will be higher. So in this case, example is given of mustard. So it is the example is that the top five countries which are producing mustard, they don't use that genetically modified mustard. Highest yields are in UK, France, Poland, Germany, and Czech Republic. They do not use these GM crops, whereas those countries that use this genetically modified mustard seeds, they are not the highest producers. For example, USA and Canada. So inefficient regulatory system is also the concern. It is said that the regulatory system that is currently in place, that is Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, so it is not independent because there is conflict of interest because of the regulatory process that is there, because a person, I'm not able to recall who chairs that Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, but yes, there is a conflict of interest because whoever chairs it is also the I don't know proper Director General of Department of Biotechnology. So certainly a person who is associated with biotechnology, and when he will be doing appraisal, he will be biased. So that conflict of interest is there. So I might be wrong in terms of designations, but some idea I have. I'm not able to recall that what this thing is, but yes, conflict of interest is there. And then there is lack of clarity. So there is no proper clarity that what will the impact of these crops will, what the impact of these crops will be on the human health and on the entire biodiversity. So it is also said that when once it is introduced, that is GM crop, then obviously pollination happens, and it is almost irreversible to withdraw that crop or that variety from the ecosystem. So that will if in any case that introduction causes adverse effect on the biodiversity, then it can't be revoked no matter what we do, because once it is introduced, pollination and all those things, interaction in the ecosystem take place, and it is very difficult to control those crops. And then threat to domestic crops is obviously there, because when genetically modified more resilient crops will be introduced, they will obviously impact wild and those native varieties of those particular species or varieties of these crops. So in fact, globally also there is a view that GM crops must not be introduced in centers of origin and biodiversity. So why, as I've told you, that these GM crops or these the toxins in them, they can target the non-intended species as well, and then that will reduce the biodiversity. And obviously for that reason, these must not be introduced in centers of origin and biodiversity. So India has already many biodiversity hotspots. For example, Eastern Himalayan Biodiversity Hotspot, then Western Ghats Biodiversity Hotspot. And then there is ethical concern that we are interfering with nature, that is violation of natural organisms' intrinsic values, so by mixing among species. So there have also been objections to consuming animal genes in plants. So what is the way forward? So simple, the thing is, you must take a balanced stance. So you can say that now, as this is coming, that that there is no proper clarity, then we must not rush with GM crops. There must be independent mechanism, independent institutional mechanism, and independent scientific evidence must be there, so that if any adverse effect is there, we must be aware of that adverse effect, and we must do whatever we can do to minimize it. And also then proper, there must be openness and transparency to allay the genuine fears, because a lot of people say that the push for GM crops is coming from those companies that are large, that are MNCs, that are engaged in this business of biotechnology and pharmaceuticals, extra. So that is the thing. So if anything is to be done, the transparency must be there, the openness must be there, but there must be participatory approach, so that all stakeholders can be brought together, so that we must develop a proper regulatory protocol that can restore trust in the process. So also then Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee needs to be a transparent body, and also there must be, it is said that if in case GM crops are harmful, and it is said that the cost of inputs is high, then there must be a better policy, there must be better pricing, and there must be rationalization of the input cost, so that the input cost can be reduced. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion about the GM crops. question. So if you like the video, if you like the discussion, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly, friends, if in case you are interested to join our daily mains answer writing initiative, you can join by using this link. This link is shown on your screen and will also be provided in the description box. So what are the benefits of joining it? The benefits are daily one question will be given to you, and on every Sunday we will be taking your one full length length test of the target topic given for the week, and comprehensive evaluation of your answers and valuable feedback will also be given to you, and reference sources relating to each question will be given to you. And also it is least costly, that you can join on a monthly basis as well. So the monthly cost is 1199, so that is near about 1200. So if in case you are interested, then do ensure that you check the link here. You can this link will be also available in the description box. And also if in case you find it costly, then you can join for in just rupees 499 per month, and can write one answer on daily basis and get it evaluated by us. But in this amount you will not be getting full length test on the alternate Sundays. So but in this case you will be getting just one question daily. So if in case you are interested to join, then do ensure that you check the link in the description box, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly, friends, we have also a Telegram channel. So on this channel we keep updating various initiatives that are taken by us for the purpose of UPSC CSC preparation. And also, if in case you are interested to remain in touch with our updates, then you can join this Telegram channel. And also lastly, if you have any queries, if you have any doubts, you can mail us at achieveias21@gmail.com, or you can also contact us at our contact number, that is 8968920720. So this is all about today's video. Thank you. Have a very nice day ahead.